Thanks again, Fred. I want to thank you for the opportunity to come again and to give you an update on the kind of research that TMI has been doing that I've been directing. And I want to say I'm especially pleased to be able to come and present to such a distinguished group as the professional division shown here. I'm not sure which one is Barbara, but I think she might be the one standing, leading the charge. Yeah, well, I noticed that. Wrong color. What I would like to do is describe the progress since the last PD seminar last year, to talk about the research program, our research activities. And I do want to start by thanking or expressing appreciation for the work of our IRB. The IRB continues. These wonderful folks continue to serve. Our mission, the mission of the IRB, which was one of the things I was asked to set up, is so that we could review all the protocols for studies that were either done here at TMI or done using TMI participants or those that were supported by TMI and done at other universities or other institutions. We wanted to make sure that all the research that we ask people to take part in is conducted by according to established ethical principles. We want to protect the human subjects in our studies. I will admit that the IRB has had nothing to do since last year. We have not received any protocols for research studies. And I hope that the situation will improve in the year ahead, because I really want to encourage you all of you, to discuss your ideas for research here with your colleagues and discuss them with me and set out to generate new projects to contribute to our research efforts in your own way, according to your own interests. So, I want to start by describing for you the current TMI research goals. And I want to say that the primary goal, the board of directors tasked me with the primary goal of trying to work with SAM signals to demonstrate that they had effects that could be shown in rigorous studies that we could publish and that would contribute to the distinction of the Monroe Institute as the flagship of the use of rhythmic auditory stimulation for the exploration of consciousness. There were three ideas or three missions that were put forward. One was to evaluate the subjective effects, in other words, the experiences that people had under SAM. And as we would vary different SAM signals in different exercises, what were the experiences that would result? To also look at the entrainment of EEG activity as a basic principle to determine whether a 4 hertz SAM signal would increase activity in the EEG at 4 hertz. And yeah, I'm sure you're all aware this is really the underpinning of our arguments about the effectiveness of hemi-sync. That we believe that hemi-sync alters EEG, which enables us to explore altered states of consciousness. The third mission is to look at objective changes in physiological activity. For example, if we create a program, SAM signals, that is that we think will produce relaxation, we want to try to measure the physiological features of relaxation. Say decreased heart rate and blood pressure, increased skin conductance, and so forth, because these are more objective results that would lend weight to our conclusions about the effectiveness of SAM. And all the studies needed to be done in rigorous, well-controlled experimental studies that would provide strong evidence. There were sort of general guidelines established for this work. Our initial efforts would use a programmable web-based survey platform that could present the SAM signals to people in their homes and also collect the study data that we needed. And I'll say a bit more about that in a minute. And also, there was a decision made to focus on relaxation as the first outcome that we wanted to investigate. Now, this decision was made for two reasons, one of which was Bob Holbrook's enthusiastic recommendation that SAM signals could provide profound relaxation in the different populations that he was working with. So we listened to that and said, well, there's a tremendous potential for the use of SAM to help people reduce stress and to learn to relax. We wanted to be able to offer experimental evidence that would back that up and support his clinical or his personal observations. The second is that there was tremendous potential for general applications of research of relaxation or stress management exercises, because this is a very big market, and if we could contribute to it with, or I should say, using the technologies that we have here in order to provide better means of producing relaxation and helping people learn, then there would be commercial opportunities, but also opportunities to benefit the public welfare. And I think the third reason, personally, is that when we were starting out with this, pursuing this idea, Bob sent me a file, and I listened to it, and I was so relaxed by the end of it that I literally could not get up out of the chair for 10 minutes afterwards, after it ended. And I just felt like I was just like liquid in there. And I gave it to a friend and colleague at Duke who was very skeptical about TMI's work, but was an expert, really, in relaxation training. And he had his own recorded program that was given out to patients to help them relax. And I said, well, you know, listen to this and just tell me what you think. And he came back and he said, you know, that was the deepest relaxation I have ever felt. And he said it reminded me of when I was learning progressive relaxation from Edmund Jacobson's people. And we had to practice for about 6 months, and the relaxation that I could achieve after 6 months of practice with the tense and release was no better than what I got listening to this program. So I was very enthusiastic about it and tried to figure out that this was a good approach for us to take to demonstrate that SAM had good effects. Now let me first review why we chose to use the web-based survey platform. This may have seemed a little strange to people when I mentioned it, even I think it was 2 years ago in our talking about our planning and last year talking about our first study. But let me just say that we do have a license right now for the use of the Qualtrics platform. And I reviewed, once we decided we were going to use web-based programming, that I looked at all the different vendors that were available, and some of them are free and some of them aren't. But I think the Qualtrics company really provided the most capability for doing the kinds of things we wanted to do. We wanted to be able to present recorded programs in the middle of a survey, and not all the platforms could do that. And the Qualtrics, really, I've just found is like the one that you could do the most with programming, that you could have it do almost anything. And even as a survey online, they were able to support reaction time studies where you could measure how long it took someone to press a key, you know, in the sort of classic reaction time study where you're measuring response times in milliseconds. So this web program is flexibly programmable. It has a lot of choices of the kinds of questions you can ask and how the stimuli are presented. In our case, the YouTube, the SAM stimuli. The cost per subject are low, and we can access large and diverse participant samples through emails. And we send emails to ask people to be in the study, and then they can click a link on the email which takes them to the survey that runs the study. And if they didn't want to do it at that time, they can save the email in their inbox and come back later and click the link then. And then they immediately go to the survey at their convenience. Now, the study can include repeated testing over time. So we could have, for each subject, we could have them complete a study session or SAM test session every day of the week, or we could for months if we wanted, and each one is recorded separately. And the thing that really appealed to me, we often talk about running research studies here at TMI, running people in the lab, and those are very special circumstances, a very special setting that's meaningful to us and to the people who would likely be available up here to be in a study, but it's not really reflective of the real-world use of tapes. We use them at home. We sit in our favorite chair. We use our headphones, the ones we like the best, and we listen at the times we think are best for us. So that when we do a web-based survey, we can recreate those conditions. So people listen at home the way they would normally listen to a program that they had downloaded or purchased. So this issue is called external validity. And it is one way that we can increase the strength of our evidence by collecting it under conditions that are more natural, more realistic. Now let me show you an example. This is what the survey would look like on your monitor. I've found it works best with desktops and laptops. It's more difficult to do it on a tablet, and some people have tried to do it on a smartphone, but the screen isn't big enough. It's possible to actually create surveys with the same platform that are suited perfectly to smartphones. But then you don't get to have the same, you don't have the same width of text and so forth. The format is different. So when we write them for running on a tablet, say, or a laptop, then it's hard to see it on a smartphone, although some of the subjects did try. So we can provide instructions, we can provide introductory text, we can ask people questions, we can collect their background information. Here in this case, they have the standard choose one kind of bubble that they click on. And also we can customize the flow of questions. In the surveys that I've written with this, we want to keep people who are under 18 out. They're not adults, and we don't want them to participate. So when the age is entered, if it's less than 18, it immediately takes them to an exit screen that says, I'm sorry, you can't be in the study. And they are unable to proceed any further with it. So there are a lot of different things that we can do to customize the questions that we ask. One other feature is that within the programming, we can have the survey itself randomize people to different experimental conditions. So I've been doing controlled studies where we have an active SAM condition, and we have a placebo condition that sounds the same but does not contain SAM signals. And the question always would be, are we sure the subject is blind to the treatment they're receiving? They don't know if they're getting the placebo. And also, is the experimenter blind to the treatment that's assigned to a subject? Or you want to make sure that certain subjects aren't specifically assigned, you know, the active treatment or such. But the program itself, the survey program, actually does all this randomizing for us. And I don't know the assignment that anyone got until the study's concluded and we download the data. And I think that's another feature that makes this application provide a more rigorous study.
Jim?
Yeah?
Sorry, not to interrupt, but a little humor introspection. Working with that Norm Shealy, I learned of not just single-blinded and double-blinded, but a triple-blinded experiments, where that's where not only does nobody knows what's going on, but people who are seeing it don't want to see it either. Basically, they just want to close their eyes.
Well, actually, you can have four tuple blinding where nobody knows what the hell is going on. So. I try to avoid that generally. Now, when we present the SAM program and SAM exercise, what the participant sees, and have any of you been in the study? Okay, that's good. For the rest of you, let me say that you see on a survey item a picture like this. And it says you press the arrow in the center to play, and when the audio ends, you scroll down and press click to go on to the follow-up questions. And we can present programs really of any length, a few minutes to an hour. And they're all presented as YouTube videos. So TMI doesn't have to host them on their server, and Qualtrics, for that matter, doesn't host them and charge for storage space, because when the button is clicked, the embedded YouTube video is presented. And we haven't used the capability of videos, but we just present sound programs, but I figured it would be nicer to have an image to, you know, while it was there as part of the survey, and it didn't cost us any more, even though it's a static image, than to just have that little narrow bar, you know, you've seen sometimes, where you press play and it just sort of creeps across on a black screen. So we have the choice, but at some future date, we could present whole videos, if that were appropriate, and have people rate them. It just occurred to me, like, we could test something like an exercise in a residential program where we would have a video of the trainer doing the briefing that leads into the exercise that then leads into the questions to ask about how the exercise felt. So there's so many things, and most of which I haven't really gotten into. We just have tremendous opportunities using this kind of platform. Now, to assess relaxation, we need to have a questionnaire. And I searched through the literature on stress reduction interventions and looked at all the different questionnaires used and came upon this one, which is called the SRSI-3. And the beauty of it is it has 38 items. And each of the items, you can see some representative items here, is scored on a 1-6 scale to describe your experience. I ask people, you know, to describe the experience during the exercise. And they can rate it on 1-6, I didn't have that at all, up to maximum. Many of the scales that are used in stress reduction studies will just ask one item, you know, how relaxed were you? Maybe even on a 6-point scale. Or they focus just on physical relaxation with multiple items. But all that, you know, arms and legs heavy and limp and muscles are relaxed and so forth. But the SRSI3 really has taken a broader approach and has four different categories of relaxation, which are sort of basic relaxation, which includes calmness, feeling peaceful and calm, but also includes scales for mindfulness, positive energy, and transcendence. And I thought that given the nature of our experiences in many SAM exercises, you know, being able to assess the degree to which people felt positive energy, or they felt mindfulness and aware, or they felt a sense of transcendence, might be very important and useful. Yeah, Barbara?
I don't understand three or four moderately. Doesn't that confuse the hell out of the statistics?
No. It doesn't confuse the statistics, but it can confuse the participant.
I've never seen it before.
I hadn't either, and I wrote the author of the questionnaire, Dr. Smith, in Chicago, and the thing, we are able to use it with his permission, but we're not allowed supposed to change it. And so he structured it that way, and I guess you could, you know, if you sit with it, it's like, well, three is less moderately than four, but it is a little bit confusing, I'll admit that. But that's the only bad feature about this questionnaire. So what I've described are sort of the general methods that we're using in all three surveys. So are there any other questions before I go on to talk about the specific ones? Okay. I reported on the first study last year, but let me just summarize it really quickly to give you the context for the second and third studies that will be new to you. The design was a random assignment to an active SAM exercise or a control exercise, and these were presented to separate groups of subjects, and every participant who volunteered was assigned at random to one group or the other, but they only heard one of these two recordings. And the program itself was 20 minutes of theta and delta frequency in a music background. And we chose theta and delta because it seemed like the best way to start was with something that was like focus 10, the focus 10 relaxation that we use with hemi-sync, where the delta theta frequencies are used to help support relaxation. And we recruited our participants from the local chapter network mailing list, which had about 1,000 people. And we sent out, we're not supposed to say invitations, but we asked these 1,000 people to take a look and see if they would be interested in the study. And we sent out 1,000 emails, and we had 450 responders who clicked the link to start the online survey. And in a 3-week period, we had 283 people complete the study. And the people were from all around the world. Even though the data were anonymous, we could tell, because of the Qualtrics capabilities, the latitude and longitude of the respondent, plus our time, so we could calculate their local time. And it was remarkable. There were people from Japan, all throughout Europe, Eastern Europe, and South America. And so 283 completed it, and after 3 weeks, we closed the study. And then going through the validity checks, we came up with 230 people that were qualified for the data analysis. The primary outcome was this SRSI-3 basic relaxation scale that includes, as I said, physical, mental, and emotional relaxation, peacefulness, and calm, and the comparisons of the active and control groups, a two-group kind of t-test thing for those familiar with it, were as follows. What I'm showing here in the graph are the histograms, which show you how many people gave each kind of response. Now the responses, the scale down here, which may be a little small for you to read, is their basic relaxation score was 0 to 60. And the scale could have only that, could only run from 6 to 66, because there was 11 items. What impressed me the most, and why I presented it this way, is the blue is the control group that only heard the music, and the red is the active SAM group that heard the theta delta SAM, and what's purple is the overlap. So there was really a tremendous overlap between the two conditions. And it's interesting, at this end, it's the control group that more frequently reported the highest relaxation scores. When you do it, when you do the data analysis, we're comparing the mean relaxation score for active versus control groups. And the mean for the active was 33.4. The mean for the music only was 34.1. And that difference, you know, was nowhere near significant. So essentially, the people responded on the basic relaxation scale the same, whether they heard SAM or didn't hear SAM. But the relaxation they reported was strongly related to the belief. So we had an item afterwards that asked people, do you think there was SAM in the program you heard or not? Or you're not sure? And participants could not, this is always included in studies like this as a way to check out whether the subjects are blind. You know, if the people can obviously tell that they heard the active program, that's a problem, a weakness in the study. But what we found was people could not reliably tell whether SAM was present. Yes, sir, Philip.
I've got a question about in that SRI.
Yeah, the questionnaire.
You've got the first one says, how relaxed you feel from 1 to 5.
One, yeah.
Then you've got a question saying, I felt amazing, awesome, unbelievable. How on earth does that correlate with relaxation? Did you just look at the I was very relaxed, just that one answer, and see how that?
Yes. Let me get to that. Yeah. Okay. I should have wanted to say from the prior slide, not only was the score for the basic relaxation scale not different, I said, okay, look, this is the first try at this. I went through every one of the 38 items, since we had 200 and some people, and said, do they differ on each item? The first one, you know, I feel really relaxed, and, you know, everyone on every subscale. And none of them were different, and they all had about the same non-difference. You know, they seemed very close to each other. So it didn't matter whether we used the basic scale of relaxation or whether we used any one item. There still were no differences between active SAM and the music control. But as I said, people could not tell whether they heard SAM or not in their exercise. But those who reported that they believed they heard SAM had higher relaxation scores than the people who were not sure, or the people who said, oh, I know I didn't hear SAM. And it didn't matter whether they had actually heard SAM or not. In other words, in the active group, the effective guessing was the same as it was in the control group. Yes, Barbara.
I thought it was feel SAM, not hear SAM. I thought it was an experiential thing, not hearing SAM.
Well, the question, yeah. Well, the thing is, everybody in the study, they know it's a SAM study. So the question is, just whether when they were listening, did they hear what they thought was SAM? Like you would say, did you hear a binaural beat? And you're right that the experience of SAM might better be described as feeling, and as the other components of it. But the thing is, if people, in general in studies, if people think they got the active drug, then that's the source of a placebo effect. So you always have to ask, do you think, essentially we're saying, do you think you got the active drug or did you get the sugar pill? That's what I was trying to get at in this. Yeah, Phil, I'll get you. Mm-hmm.
Do you think there's enough distance between those points? You have 5 points. No, not much. Neutral, a bit more. Yeah. And someone says you play some music, you're going to be relaxed. Yes, 1 point over. And for some to be then effective in that scale, you have to be amazingly relaxed, right? So if you sort of said, no, it's a scale of 1 to 100, 50 is neutral, 100 is amazing. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
The actual scale.
Well, that could be. However, the real issue is the fact that even when they're listening to Sam, the red bars, a lot of people are giving scores of 6 out of 66, or 7, or 10. You know, in other words, they're not getting it at all, or they aren't feeling, well, we're assuming they're not feeling relaxed during the exercise by their report of how relaxed they felt during the exercise. Sure.
But before, I feel relaxed now, and now I'm going to be more relaxed, or is it a case of, how relaxed are you?
In the first study, it was at the end, and it was, how relaxed did you feel during the exercise? Well, but I just wait, and I'll show you what we've advanced with. Yes?
Were the subjects queried on whether they had a prior Sam experience or not?
Not specifically related to Sam. These were, as I said, local chapter network members, and we did ask them background information about, have you ever had a residential course? How many CDs or tapes do you own? How many outreach programs have you gone to, and so forth? But essentially, that showed pretty much everybody was familiar, at least with hemi-sync kinds of things, even if they hadn't heard Sam particularly.
But the idea if they had a prior positive group experience identified as Sam, that could influence their expectations.
It could. So, just to summarize, what I was saying last year was our first attempt at this found no effects of SAM, but an effect of belief. And so you say, well, okay, I mean, not every first time you try an experimental study design, it doesn't work most times, or if it does work, you're very fortunate, or you're very brilliant. So we wanted to go on. We still had we had access to the same platform. We wanted to do a second study to either confirm or refute the results of the first study. So the second study, we wanted to build on the first, what we had learned from the first. And this again had assignment to active SAM or control groups. So each person heard one exercise. It was either SAM or it wasn't SAM. And it had 20 minutes of theta delta, but we added gamma into the exercise. Now we did this essentially because, you know, we thought, Bob suggested that, you know, the gamma might really be an important component of the total SAM experience. So we thought as our incremental step, we would add gamma signals into the SAM. And we recruited people from the sample of the first study who were willing to do another study. A lot of the people on the mailing list said, no, they either didn't respond at all, or they said they weren't interested in being in the study. So we wanted to take the people who were and were willing to stay with us. So we only had 62 volunteers this time. So again, the principal step in study two was to add gamma. And we did have different background music. So the other thing is that we added, I was concerned that we might be seeing so much variability, so much variation in people's reports of relaxation at the end because they started out with such variation at the beginning. Some people being very relaxed when they sat down to begin, some people not feeling relaxed at all. So I used a visual analog scale before the test stimulus to assess relaxation at that moment, the before SAM or control. And this one worked. The person with their mouse could slide this little blue arrow back and forth between the two endpoints of how not at all relaxed now to totally relaxed now. So we could get a simple assessment of their initial level of relaxation. The other thing you would expect if people, but if people were really high in their initial relaxation, there would not be much room for SAM to increase relaxation. And if someone was not relaxed when they started, they would have more room to move up. So this second study had two changes or two additions. Now, I want to just play an excerpt of the program for you. And again, this is Bob has been very helpful collaborating with me, both in trying to figure out what to do next, how to interpret what we find, and also to prepare the different SAM programs. So if you could... People love this. A lot of people love this music. Let me see, I wrote it down. This is A Soothing Caress by Christopher Lloyd Clark, which we were able to use. I actually emailed Clark and he said, yes, we had his permission to use this royalty free, since we were doing research studies and we were all such fine people. Now, one thing to, that I think I should mention for Bob's sake, he was a big proponent of, say, starting with one set of signals and then adding in the gamma later. But we were only running a 20-minute exercise, much shorter than we commonly see. And so we decided it would be best to have all three, gamma, theta, delta, presented, and they faded in during the first 10 seconds and then faded out at the end. But they were constant throughout the 20 minutes. And in the control program, this is the active program, in the control program, we included the same carrier tones, but they were not, they didn't have the SAM effect. You know, they didn't have that, they didn't have the SAM effect. So essentially, except for this, what you might hear in terms of the apparent movement of the tone, the two things sounded the same. And you'll see when I, in a minute, that people couldn't tell. So again, we used the same 38-item SRSI-3. I didn't want to switch to a new questionnaire while we were also changing what people were listening to while we were, you know, doing the different things. Because when you do that, you can't tell what mattered, which change was the important one and which change didn't matter. So we stuck with this questionnaire despite its possible limitations. And the results with the basic relaxation scale, again, were there was no difference between the active and control groups. And again, I plotted here the histograms for the two groups separately rather than overlapping them, because that's sort of, I thought it might be confusing. And you can see each group had 31 people in it. The mean relaxation score for the group that heard SAM was 39, and this again is on a 6 to 66 scale. The mean for the group that only heard the music was 38.9. So they differed by a tenth of a point on this 60-point range. But the other thing I want to say is the range in this one group of scores went from 19 to 53. In other words, some people listened to SAM and they did not feel at all, or more or less at all, relaxed. And other people had a score almost as high as it could possibly be. The same was true for the control group. Some people reported at the end of A Soothing Caress, that they were not relaxed, and other people were very relaxed. And again, guessing was related to their relaxation score. If they thought they had had heard Sam in an experienced Sam, they reported higher levels of relaxation than people who said, no, I didn't, I know I didn't get Sam. And the maybe group was in the middle. And the differences among these three levels of certainty were highly significant. The p-value, well, this one actually wasn't, but it was 0.029. So there were significant differences between them. Only 29% of people were able to guess correctly. In other words, they said yes and they had gotten it, or they said no and they hadn't gotten it. And about the same percent were unsure. So it really broke out like a third of the people, more or less, got it right, guessed right, a third guessed wrong, and a third didn't know. When Sam was not presented, only two people said that it was, and 14 said, no. When Sam was not presented, only two people said, I didn't hear any Sam. But 14 said, yes, I did hear Sam. And 15 said, I'm not sure. When Sam was presented, 16 said, yes, I heard it. 11 said, no. And 5 were unsure. So there were a lot of hallucinating people, I suppose. I want to make sure, you know, the thing is, looking at this, this is like a correlation. We can't establish that their guess caused them to report higher relaxation, greater relaxation. So we don't know if this is like a placebo effect, that their expectations, their beliefs caused the outcome, the higher score. It could as well been that they, you know, honestly did say, as we asked them first, how relaxed were they? And then they think, yeah, I was pretty relaxed. So they give a 50 or a 60 score, right? And then a few items later, we say, what do you think you got? They might well be saying, well, you know, I said a 50 or 60, so it must have been the same. You know, it could go either way. But it is remarkable in this study, as in the first, that although there was no difference due to what they heard, there was a difference due to what they thought they heard.
Jim?
Yeah?
Did they know prior to this that this was a SAM study?
Yes.
What would have happened if they didn't know? If it was just, you're going to listen to music and we have a couple of kinds of music and we're just going to see how relaxed you are?
Well, I made the decision that in order to enable informed consent to be in the study, we should tell people that they were might be listening to SAM, and that SAM was a new technology developed for rhythmic auditory stimulation and so forth. And I'm not comfortable with hiding too much unless we absolutely have to in order to do the study. So for ethical reasons, I told them essentially what was going on. And I even told them that your chances of hearing Sam are 50-50. And it'll be totally random. And you won't know what group you're assigned to, and I won't know, and everything. So I wanted to make all of that clear to them for ethical reasons.
So for ethical reasons, did you then explain exactly what Sam was?
Briefly. And I did that in the invitation, the email that I sent, you know, with the link to the study. I did like an informed consent form in that, in the body of that email. And I did, I mean, what can we tell them? We can tell them that SAM is a new method of rhythmically producing rhythmic, I don't know, but you we all know sort of what we're talking about. And that it was, we thought it was a provide rhythmic stimulation in the signal, and that it was experimental and so forth. That it was, nobody had, Well, there were few reported ill effects, being fair to you. But, you know, essentially saying, and that we didn't think there'd be any harm and so forth. Yeah. I guess I'm 30 years in a medical center IRB setting has made me very obsessive about including all these details and doing this all. Yes, doctor.
Sorry, it's a bit funny. Don't you think it's a bit strange about the target audience that by all accounts that music does sound relaxing, but half of them say, I don't feel relaxed after listening to it for 20 minutes. Something not quite...
It's odd.
The thing is then, if it's a case of that music is playing, then by default 50% are going to say, regardless of whether the sound's played or not, I don't feel relaxed after listening to it. So if you then say, well, Sam has now only got a 50% chance of making the other people do a little.
In the first study, I actually let people have an open-ended item to express themselves. And regardless of what the music is, some people hate it. You know, I didn't like it. It sounds like 80s new age music. It just, I like my exercises with no music. You know, I mean, it was very interesting how great the individual differences are in even in people who are homogeneous in the fact they've all experienced this kind of stuff. But maybe that contributes to it. In other words, some people said, I only like Sam exercises with no music. You know, oh, I love the music. You know, where can I buy it? I have to have a copy of it. You know.
So music is now conflating the answer.
Well, let me go a little further with it, and we'll get to that, I think. But at this point, as I said, we're showing that guessing matters, or the belief matters as to what was heard. And it didn't matter. In other words, here it's plotted by the two groups, active and control groups, and you can see that the effects of guessing are the same, or pretty much the same, regardless of whether they had active SAM or control music, or just the music. I want to show here, I could compare the pre and post visual analog scale scores, right? Before they listened, after they listened. And this was a 100-point scale. And as you can see at the beginning on the left, the pre-treatment level of relaxation had a lot of variability, but the two groups did not differ. On a 100-point scale, they're coming in, the active group was 62.9, the control group was 55. So that's sort of in the middle, the high end of the middle. But look here, too, this is the standard deviation, which is that measure similar to what was shown on those histograms, that a 23, 24-point standard deviation on a 100-point scale is incredible variability. So that really means you would probably have to have a difference in the mean of 25 points out of 100 in order to see it be significant. But the change in relaxation from pre to post was significant. It was actually, let me see, I have that written down here. It was 25 or 26 points on the 100-point scale, and the p-value was 0.0001. So in comparison...
where's that there?
Where's that? I didn't put the p-value. Well, it's down here at the bottom, is it? Yeah. So in other words, both groups increased in their relaxation score. By 24, 25 points out of 100. And that's starting from a baseline of, you know, close to 60. So the music was relaxing, or both conditions elicited relaxation. And the thing they had in common was the music. But again, this outcome did not show any difference between SAM and music alone. So it just gets worse from here. Two studies in a row find that SAM signals do not elicit greater feelings of relaxation. You know, and it's sort of, what now? It's sort of a fork in the road, but I don't know if it's so much a fork in the road as a dead end at this point. We had two different studies. One was theta and delta signals. One was theta, delta, gamma signals in music. And the SAM presentation did not elicit greater relaxation. Yes, oh good, hands up. Mm-hmm. Lee, well, let Lee go first, then Frank.
Correct me if I'm wrong. The studies were done on folks that have basically been trained with hemi-sync. These two studies?
Probably so, yeah.
So that's a factor.
Yep.
And then Bob's studies and results are done with the clinical studies with more towards addiction or PTSD.
Yep.
Clients that are not hemi-sync. He's getting tremendous results, and the hemi-sync, and again, this was a limited. What now?
All right, now see, let's just stop, because I'm trying to build suspense, and you're proving that I'm successful, at least for you, in that regard. Frank, what was your question?
Supposing instead of playing music, you put white noise over it.
All right, now wait, you gotta suspend for a moment, because we'll get to that next. Suzanne?
I think the music is probably your big variable, if indeed there is a difference. And I think we have to hold the possibility that these results are exactly what's going on. However, there are studies that show that people get better results if it's music they like. And so one possibility would be, instead of having a standard piece of music, that you might have two or three or four choices where in both groups people could select what music would you like to listen to.
That's a possibility. It's a more complicated study, and I'm trying to keep it simple.
Okay.
Yes, Norm.
I had two choices.
Yeah, I see your point. Norm?
Well, way back in the Dark Ages, when I did a study on the effect of hemi-sync,
mm-hmm.
on depth of relaxation compared with photostimulation or the two together, what we found was that relaxation is relaxation, and it was only a depth that you could go to. In other words, hemi-sync worked well, photostimulation worked well, two together didn't add anything because both worked. Have you compared with exactly the same music, hemi-sync, with the SAM?
No. No, as I said this at the beginning, our focus right now is on trying to show that SAM has effects, you know, that justify using SAM. And since SAM is a product unique to TMI that's not available from all the competitors, we are, you know, it just is a very good idea to show that ours works. And then we show that ours works better. But we don't worry about whether it works better till we know that it works at all. Yeah, fit, okay.
We had been told that a lot of people described their experience with SAM as offering them almost laser focus, as mm-hmm. opposed to being very relaxed, and that was because of the additional gamma stimulation. Maybe rather than seeing if SAM replicates what hemi-sync can do, would it be possible to look at what SAM might be able to do that hemi-sync is?
I'll get to that in a few minutes. Yeah, let me go on from this point now, but I do want to leave time for questions once all is revealed. So we're at this, what are we going to do now? We still have a contract. We can still offer studies. So let's just say, what are the common features of our two studies are that they both had separate groups for active and control, right? And each person only heard one of the two possibilities. And this is a fine design, a very rigorous experimental design. And the second common thing was that there was relaxing background music. So one of the things you do when you're in this kind of situation is you say, which one of these is the problem? You know, which one screwed me up here? Our results are that there are lots of variability in the response scores, in the relaxation scores, in both conditions, which seems crazy. That there were very small differences observed due to the presence of Sam. But there were big differences related to belief or expectation. Okay. Did the relaxing music obscure the effects of Sam's stimuli? Someone brings that up. You know, if the music is so relaxing, there's no more room for improvement due to Sam. Could the individual differences or the variability, could we possibly eliminate that so that we would better be able to see the effects of Sam? So then this guided our decisions for the next study. The third Sam study made two changes. What we did was change to an experimental design where each participant heard both the active and the control programs on different days. And the whichever one they had first was assigned at random. So they might hear Sam first or they might hear the control first. But they would hear them both. And we asked, listen, you know, pretty much under the same conditions and so forth. But now each person, so what matters in a study like this is what's the difference for that person between those two conditions. That way, if they're a low, relaxed person, it doesn't matter. We're just looking at the change for them. And if they're a high, relaxed person or a medium, relaxed person in general as a trait, then we're only comparing each person with him or herself. And this, I've found, is a stronger study when there's so much variability, when people are so much different from each other. The SAM program we changed, we took the music out. But we had the same delta, theta, gamma frequency stimuli in just pink noise, which I will call pink noise. Bob said it was brown noise. But, you know, that's a distinction without a difference sometimes. But it was the same kind of noise that we're often used to hearing, the pink noise background. And we had 78 volunteers who completed both test sessions and provided us with data. I thought that by removing the music, we would be able to emphasize whatever effects Sam had. And I also thought that the presence of music would encourage expectation effects because they thought the music was relaxing and, you know, it might be better just to leave it out and just use the pink noise. So here we have, you can hear the program that we used. Sam, if you could. There you go, 20 minutes of this. But it is, what do you call it, Bob? How it moves, orbiting brown noise. So it's not just the constant hiss. Yeah, so. But this was the active condition. And obviously people are allowed to make it louder, softer, whatever suits them. Okay, obviously it's different than having what was it? A gentle caress, you know, going on in the background. So here's what we get with the pink noise and the SAM. Does it look anything like study two? When we just look at the two conditions separately, you know, we see all this crazy variability. And we would say, hey, there's not going to be much, there's no difference there. But that's not the statistical test we're using here. Remember, what we want to do is calculate the difference for each person and then look at whether the differences on average are different from zero or is the difference between zero. So here, what I plotted, the distribution of active control differences, active minus control. So each person's active relaxation score minus their control relaxation score. And I hope you could see this runs from minus 35 to 35 as the difference. So some people, the mean is minus 1.8, which means the active was a little teeny bit less relaxing than the pink noise alone. And the t-test wasn't significant. So the third study with a different design produces the same result, that we cannot find a difference in basic relaxation score due to SAM, or the presence or absence of SAM. Not only that, figure, for some people, down here, the active SAM, their relaxation score was 25 points lower than it was and under pink noise alone. But for other people, their relaxation score was 25 points better in the SAM when they listened to SAM. Guess what? Guessing whether SAM was present or not was again linked to the outcome, to the relaxation score. And again, you see, if people, yes, I heard SAM today, or no, I didn't, when they heard SAM today, when they were sure they did, then they reported higher relaxation. Yes, Frank?
Or maybe the other way around.
Yeah. Yes.
If they felt more relaxed, they said it must have been
SAM. They said it must have been SAM. That's right. And I do, yeah, it's good for you to bring that up. I want to just hammer that we can't say that their belief caused their report, because the report was collected first. And it's equally possible that the report led to the conclusion it must have been SAM. But the effect of what they guessed was significant in both, no matter whether they actually heard SAM or not. And again, they really couldn't guess reliably. VAS scores, remember the 100 millimeter or the 100 point line where they reported their initial relaxation level and their final relaxation level. Again, the two groups did not differ initially in relaxation, they reported. And yet, and the change from pre to post was significant for both groups. They both increased relaxation by the same amount. And again, this is, I need to be cautious in this, because we're talking here not about two kinds of people, but about the same person under two conditions. So the average would be, essentially that both conditions were relaxing. So then now what do we do? So the question that came to mind, talking to Bob about this, talking to Scooter about this, you know, is relaxation the wrong place to look? You know, we know, those of us who've experienced SAM, probably everyone, knows what their experience was like, and it might not be well described as, oh, I was so relaxed, I felt so calm and peaceful. Maybe that's the wrong place to look. Although, remember, I wanted to look here because this could have a lot of application for inpatients in a hospital who need to relax while they're lying there, and they get tired of watching CNN and the Weather Channel. My hope was that we could develop a relaxation tape. But we know that SAM stimulation might elicit more complex effects on consciousness beyond simple relaxation. But how would we know where to look? It's not enough to second, third, or fourth guess, well, after three studies, I guess it's third guessing, and say that, oh, well, obviously relaxation was the wrong place to look. That might be true, but where do you want to look? You know, what's your idea, Lee?
For clarity.
So we would have the Fisher scale of clarity and see what the scores were. It's a strange thing. You could say clarity, there might not be a way to measure subjective clarity that's accepted, you know, in science. Maybe nobody's really looked at clarity before. We could do like a mindfulness scale. You know, do you feel more mindful now? But the SRSI-3 had items, had a scale that measured things related to mindfulness. So let me tell you what I did.
But before you go ahead,
yes,
I wonder, do you cluster together all the items of the SRSI, mm-hmm. and what happens if you break them down? Like, for example,
look at each item?
No, in terms of sub-scales. Like, for example, mental relaxation, mm-hmm. emotional relaxation, and physical relaxation.
Well, I have done it where we actually looked at each item. So an item might say, I feel physically relaxed, and yet it's not different in the two conditions.
Yeah, but one item doesn't...
No, but then the next item would be, I feel peaceful and calm. I mean, there were all the things, I think it gave good coverage of the things that we would say go along with feeling relaxed. And even if you can use the scales that Smith developed, the subscales, or you can just look at the items, it always comes out the same, or it has so far. Yeah, Frank?
It occurs to me, I think you measured exactly what you asked for. You're getting, here's what I feel. You're not measuring relaxation at all. You're measuring somebody's perception of whether they're relaxed.
Yes. Yes, it's a good point. I mean, I would think, I'll get to that too in a minute. Get to everything in a minute. Yeah, Lee?
Maybe it's time to add in the biofeedback.
Oh, see, here's a spoiler alert. Before we do that, before we jump down that rabbit hole, let me say what I did do. In other words, we don't know what we want to look for. What's the important feature? So, in study one, I mentioned this earlier, there was an open-ended item. You know, describe your experience in as much detail as you care to. And some people wrote very long descriptions. And not everyone provided a description. But what I wanted to do is look through these descriptions where people describe their experience. And especially if they had a great, a fantastic experience, they're going to tell you. If it was, then they might just leave it blank. But you'd be sure to get the big things. And what we wanted was to find the big things as a target, as a next target, right? So I am not an expert in qualitative analysis. I don't even play one on TV, but I was talking to my friend John Kruth at the Rhine. He had just written a paper summarizing the different methods of qualitative analysis. And I said, well, can I do something simple-minded? And he said, well, you probably can. So we had, this is, I remember, 280-some people. Now, they didn't all have responses, but there were some in the active and some in the control condition. And what I did was read through all of them and try to figure out if there were underlying themes that we could sort of say, okay, a category, right? I'll show you the categories in a minute. But I came up with 13 sort of common categories that were typically reported by people. And then I went back and looked at each person's response independent or blind to whether they were active or control. And then just said, okay, do they report something in this category? Yes, no, 0, 1, you know. Or they do report in this. They report this kind of thing, this category of experience. Does that make sense? And again, this is a very rough approach to this. So, just to show you, I have three text things which are going to be too small to read. But let me just go through some of the long one here. These were all from the control group. It said, Very soon after the music started, my third eye chakra and solar chakra were activated. I then felt a gentle pulsing behind my eyes. I did not doze off at any point, but did feel drowsy. But suddenly I would experience something that felt like a consciousness shift. I would be extremely aware in the present, and yet time did not matter. I experienced some flashing images, very high definition, which is unusual for me. And I particularly remember a brief image of a cut in someone's skin with a fly-like being or object perched at the end. This went on. I've only gotten down to here. So, you know, there's twice as much in this. They had a very complete experience. I mean, you know, it was busy. They were busy. No, they were just listening to the music, which I will get to in a minute. So we have the categories. Can you see the labels on the left? Okay. So I just categorized. In other words, did they say, I like the music? Now, a lot of people didn't mention the music, but some people said, I really like the music, I like the music. Did they feel relaxed? Did they mention relaxed? Did they mention calm and peaceful kinds of things? Did they mention, I had these weird physical sensations, an itch in my foot or a pain, you know, anything related to something in the body? Did they talk about having a lot of thoughts? You know, buzzing my monkey mind to, you know, I just kept thinking about what I had to do that day. Their mind wandered. Did they specifically say something like that? My mind was quiet. You know, I had a quiet mind. It felt like meditation for me when I meditate. And then the things I thought were interesting is like simple images. If they reported like flashes of color, you know, just color or a shape or something very brief, very short. Or did they report complex images? I saw a field of flowers. You know, I saw a unicorn. I saw anything like that that's more complex than just a color or a shape. Did they report visits to other realms? Okay. And we all know what that means. Did they report contact with another being or guidance from their guide? Did they meet deceased relatives? Those sorts of things. And then finally, did they feel energy flow? You know. So the bottom scale goes 0 to 1, and the bars tell you what percent of the people reported something or multiple things in each category. What surprised the hell out of me, the control group members for each category more frequently reported an experience in that category. Now, I couldn't figure out a way to test whether this is significant statistically, you know. And I think it was enough to say that it was not clear that there was any category of experience, you know, among these, that was commonly reported where Sam led to more of it. So it's probably, again, there was probably no difference between the two. So this did not help. It did not tell me where to go next. Yes?
Well, actually, what that brings up to me is if you look for a confounding variable like physical discomfort, that could explain everything, whereas Sam in a small percentage creates headache or nausea, and that would explain everything. And if you took those people out, then you might see something different.
Well, in this analysis, only if they said, you know, I had a headache or nausea. I don't think, there were people who had headaches when they started that went away, but nobody talked about nausea in either group. Let me get John in the back.
I actually was thinking about, I think what Lee said, focus. You have greater, actually blah, 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 a lot of experiences, a lot of talking in the control group, and you have less.
A little less. Yeah, it might be a not significantly less or meaningfully less. Yeah, and I always wonder too, well, what about the people who didn't say anything? You know, and we were not prompting them other than just say whatever you like, tell us whatever you think, you know. I was actually trying to be kind, because I know when people do studies, if something happens, I didn't get to say what I thought, you know. I didn't get to tell the story of what happened to me. So we just put this in, figuring it didn't cost anything. And then, but it's very incomplete. And we certainly didn't ask them to describe any images that they might have had or whatever. So we probably missed a lot of stuff that actually happened to people. And for one reason or another, they just didn't feel like telling us, you know, in that little box. Yeah, Suzanne.
I'd like to just follow up with a thought with Greg's comment. And that is, I think that in almost everything, it's not like us versus them. I think there's a continuum. And somebody may have headaches, they may have nausea, they may have whatever, but that's at the extreme end. My guess is that there is a continuum with this where there are going to be people for whom Sam doesn't fully fit, mm-hmm. who are experiencing a mild, undescribable discomfort that keeps them from having a full experience.
Okay.
And I think it would be very interesting to, you know, to find out more about these people.
It would be. I have just 12 minutes left, so let's hold the rest of the questions till the end. And I'm always happy to answer them afterward as well. So this attempt, boy, I'll tell you, it's like another failure for me. You know, it's just, yeah, well, you know. I know. So here we have all these studies taken together. Their results lead to a simple conclusion. All right, now here's, it's just a drum roll. So here's my conclusion. Yeah, Auntie Sam, that'd be good. But again, to beat a dead horse, or at least a non-significant horse, three studies, and I could not find an effect of SAM on basic relaxation or any of the other relaxation scores, transcendence, mindfulness, you know, energy flow, and so forth, that were offered by the questionnaire. The visual analog scales didn't show anything, and even worse, the free response things made it look like other kinds of experiences were more common if you weren't listening to SAM. So, after these three strikes, should we send Sam back to the dugout? You know, some people would say, well, if it's not going to work, you know, just stop. We'll stop. You know, hasta la vista, Sam. At least the Sam research, because we know it works. It produces strong experiences in programs with that people are participating in. We could conclude there's nothing there. But remember, we're talking about nothing there for simple relaxation. A different measure of experience might be successful.
Yeah, galvanic skin response.
Right.
SAM effects might take more than 20 minutes to really appear. The difference is, if we'd run like a standard 40-minute or 45-minute exercise, maybe we would have seen something just because it takes more time to see it. And maybe a different pattern of SAM signals, say something including alpha or other things. Another kind of SAM signal might show something with a different kind of outcome measure. So I hope you get that, the idea I'm trying to say. Even though what I was trying to establish with these studies is a consistency in the results, but they are all limited to measures of simple relaxation. And that was because my goal was to develop a simple relaxation exercise that people who didn't know about TMI could listen to and feel more relaxed. There are always lots of details that can be changed in these studies. One of my advisors at UCLA taught me that there are a lot of ways for a study to fail, and maybe only a few that will work. And it is true, when I was starting out in biofeedback at the dawn of that field, nobody knew how to show that biofeedback worked. Until somebody found how to show that biofeedback worked, then everybody else imitated that same method. But there was a lot of tinkering that needed to be done to find out what kind of study was the most appropriate. We can't reach a general negative conclusion about SAM based upon these studies. It might be that we haven't found the right conditions. Okay. Even I was reading Tom Campbell's My Big Toe, and he talked about the early days with hemi-sync at Whistlefield, and he said they spent years in a cut and try mode. You know, they would have something and they would try it out, and if it worked, it didn't work. Then they would try something different on people, try something different until they found, till Monroe found, what kinds of binaural beat patterns seemed to be the most effective, and that he could show that consistently. So that's where we are. We're in a cut and try. We just don't move as forward as fast, but we have more people in the studies than the old days, the Whistlefield days. But there is one conclusion I think is fair. I hope you'll agree with me. So I put this in a frame. Our experience determines our experience. So what we all have learned and practiced regarding the exploration of consciousness, especially with TMI's technology, what we've learned influences the experiences we have. Monroe said that we use hemi-sync or SAM, well, he would say hemi-sync, in order to learn how to access different states of consciousness. But then we should drop these training wheels, right? Give them to somebody else and continue on accessing different states of consciousness without them, right? Without the sound patterns. We learn this at Gateway. It's in the basic exercises we do. And we probably all have done this. We can close our eyes right now and access by this one breath method, focus 10, 12, 15, sometimes I can do 21 even this way, and any other of the levels, because we have accessed them before and we've learned then what we need to do to access them right now. So should we be surprised that the participants in the studies who are part of the local chapter network haven't done the same? At least many of them have already learned to access the, say, focus 10 kinds of things, the mind awake, body asleep, or the relaxed body, just through their practice. And all they have to do is sit in their favorite chair, put headphones on, and they're gone. I mean, that's true for most of us, I'm sure. So the context, the cues, the expectations all play a role. So what experience we've had determines what we will experience each time. And it may well be that the participants in this study did not respond to SAM because they didn't have to. They were going to have an experience no matter what they heard, if they thought that it was likely. We could have greater success if we tested people who were more naive about what should happen, who hadn't had this experience. Somebody raised this already. Like my friend at Duke, even though he had never heard a hemi-sync program before, let alone SAM, when he listened to that SAM relaxation, he was powerfully affected by it. So perhaps we need to find, now I've, find naive folks, college students, sophomores, you know, this kind of thing, if we can find them sober. There are people in the communities that could participate who weren't familiar with our work. And in fact, that population would be more like the population I would hope to help. You know, the cancer clinic patients and so forth, the inpatients in the hospital. So we really need to keep in mind the importance of experience. And I don't see nodding heads, but I know that you're nodding on the inside. Although Brian here was nodding on the outside. So where do we go from here? What really would be a good step, a good path to take in the year ahead? Obviously, we could try survey studies with and try to find naive individuals. Maybe each of you has a neighbor who knows nothing about, you know, TMI, and they would be a naive person to test in this study. I haven't quite figured out the best way to access these folks, but we could do that. Another idea I had is we could look at SAM's effects on directed experiences. I always have in my mind the one quarterly tape that came out where it describes walking up a path, up a hill, with a stream nearby, and you're climbing, and as you get to the top on a sunny day with flowers blooming here and blackberries over here, and then you get to a cave, and inside the cave there's a chest, like a treasure chest, and you open the treasure chest, and inside is the answer to the problem you have, right? I loved that exercise, and I love exercises like that, and I was thinking, well, Sam, with the awareness, with the different experiences that seem to accompany Sam, would that be more intense? Would that be more vivid? You know, would your imagery be more complete, more vivid, and better? Would the answer that you got be a better answer? It would be really nice if we could use something, use Sam, especially with the gamma effects, to do that. So that's another possibility. But I do think we need to take the direction of collecting physiological measurements to test SAM. In order to demonstrate the effects of SAM, we have a couple of basic questions. Can SAM change EEG activity? Entrainment. Can SAM relaxation exercises, guided or not, produce a relaxation response similar to those seen in transcendental meditation back in the 60s and 70s, Herb Benson's work, so forth. Many other stress management interventions have looked at the physiology. So we need a place to do this, and I have found the Rhine Research Center. It's in my hometown of Durham, and I've been going over there a lot, good folks. They're part of the alliance that we've established for global consciousness. Here you see their building on the left, and it has a library. It's really the Rhine, if you don't know, is the leading parapsychology research place in the world. And it's famous for the work of J.B. Rhine, who was a Duke professor in the psychology department, who essentially coined the term extrasensory perception. And he was tasked by his dean to find a way to show that information could be transmitted without the use of any of the five senses, which is why they call it extrasensory perception. And many of the initial paradigms that we think of commonly now, you know, the cards with the wavy line or the star and all, they're called Zener cards. That was developed by Rhine. A lot of the basic paradigms were developed by Rhine, and running people thousands of trials, they established really the basic phenomena of clairvoyance, telepathy, psychokinesis. What else is there? Well, anyway, all of them. And Rhine retired in the 60s, but his legacy continues in the Rhine Research Center. They have in there a lab that has two shielded chambers. You can see sort of from the outside on the left and the inside, the subject, these were used for telepathy kinds of studies. And the participant sits in the comfy chair and you have all the equipment outside to collect all the measurements you're doing. So what I am presently doing is working with John Kruth, the executive director at the Rhine, to set up a lab in this facility, where we will have people get hooked up with whatever we think is appropriate, sit in the chair. It's acoustically shielded, it's electrically shielded, you close the door, and we'll be able to record from outside the different physiological signals. We can then play SAM, hemi-sync exercises, and measure the changes in physiology. Now, when I was leaving Duke, I was able to salvage a BioPack system. This is one brand of this sort of computerized data acquisition. And mine is about 15 years old now, but what it is a modular system. You see, it looks like a bookshelf, and these individual modules each measure one kind of measurement. One's skin conductance, one's for heart rate, one's for EEG, one's for respiration. And you just sort of stuff them all together, and you can have up to 16 channels of recording at one time. And then that connects to a computerized system, which then connects to your computer to store the data. And here on the table is, one of these EEG caps that makes it easy to record EEG. So what we want to do is simple studies to start. EEG entrainment, single frequency, can we do it? Can we get some measurements of body asleep? If we played at focus 10, like free throw focus 10 or intro to focus 10, at the end, would we be able to see a relaxation response? And then once we have done simple studies, we'll move on to more complex studies. And that's the end of what I wanted to update you on today. So we are moving ahead with the psychophysiological measurements, and obviously if we have more money, we'll be able to do more, and we'll continue with the survey work. Yeah.
Could it be that relaxation might not be the main thing that you want to look for? The reason is that I've been taking a lot of the same courses. I don't see them as relaxing. I see them as getting great clarity.
Okay. And I'm saying, let's talk about that and see if you can come up with what we want to call what we're looking for. Yeah. You had a question from earlier, so.
I just would like to congratulate you. After 23 years of listening to TMI research, this is the first time I've seen real good research.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate that. Yeah, and on that positive note, I think I better just leave the room.